So yes, I'll just say that I'm Gina Mott and this is Lens Miller and we are part of the new Emotional Health and Wellbeing Practitioner team. Can I just say thank you very much for having us. I really enjoyed the workshops this morning and I've enjoyed actually meeting people. I've seen names around and to actually put sort of faces to the names is really good. And the lunch was a nice added bonus as well. So, who are we? So we are a completely new team that's gone in. So we've got 7 emotional health and wellbeing practitioners. We've got 1 clinical lead, which is Sarah, and she's a clinical psychologist. We've also got an assistant psychologist, who's Lois. We have an admin. That's a bit ambitious, actually. We don't have an admin, but we will have an admin to help us. And we are aiming to cover the whole of Cambridgeshire and Peterborough between us. We're in bases, so we've got bases in Huntington, Peterborough, Cambridge, Ely and Fenland. So we're kind of spreading ourselves out. We're a very unusual team. We are starting from scratch. That doesn't happen very often in the NHS. Usually you sort of have a team that's adapted or whatever, but no, we're completely from the beginning. So we are finding our feet. We actually launched on the 15th of January, so as I say, very new. The other unusual thing about us is that we're actually a collaboration between CCS, which is Cambridge Community Services, and CPFT, which are the mental health services. So some of our workers are employed by the mental health workers and some are by CCS, and this is the first team like this to have happened. I think we will be seeing more, which will be good. There was a lot of planning went in to this team coming about, lots of meetings were attended, and a real need was identified that we hope we're going to be able to fill. I was given some statistics just this week that 50% of the referrals made to the spa in CAMHS are not appropriate for spa. And when we looked at the early health assessments in Peterborough, only 10% of those actually go through to the MAS panel. The rest are actually end up being helped by universal services. So we're kind of in this, we're going to help that, we hope. So we are quite a diverse bunch of people they've managed to get together. We're all clinicians. We've all used to working with young people. We've all got a strong mental health either training or background additional training. So in our group, we've got school nurses, mental health nurses, social workers, and psychologists. I think the reason that they haven't just recruited, say, 7 mental health nurses or whatever is because they want those other experiences that we can all bring to things, which are good. We're all clinicians, we're all specialists, and we're used to dealing with young people in mental health. Okay, so move to the team. This is a mail shot that should have gone out to all the schools. I don't know if any of you have seen it. Have you seen it? Yeah? Did it get to the right people? I think with true efficiency, it went out before Christmas without any contact details on, and then it was resent again after Christmas. So we've got a central base in Huntington, which is going to be our main, where our main inquiries and referrals go. We're quite unique. We have been allowed to be a service that's set up, and the way to get to us is just to pick up the phone or send us an email. So there's no referral forms or anything like that. Anyone can get hold of us. We'd like all the referrals to come into the main office, particularly at the moment, because we're obviously collating things. What happens is we're taking it in turns to be on duty, so we're on the end of the phone. So when you ring, you know, it might be that the conversation you have with that clinician on the phone there is enough to answer your query. Most of them, I think, will then be the person on the phone will then send them on to the person who's working in your area. Okay, so you're going to get to know us, we hope. So in the Peterborough area, you've got myself and Faye Barnsdale, who is also on there. Oh, there, she is, second one in from this side of the place. So you're going to get to know us personally, hopefully, as well. We are going to get back to you, so it is really important when you ring in that you give us your contact details of where it's best to ring you, and the hours that it's convenient to ring you in as well. Obviously, if you're working in school, it's no good me ringing you at 10 o'clock in the morning and actually you're teaching for the rest of the day. You know, say to us, can we be running off to help us three? That's fine, we're happy to do that. And we'll come in and have discussions. My colleague Lois is now going to tell you about the I Thrive model, which is kind of where we are coming from and where it's been decided that the need is. And so she's going to explain that to you, because she's better at it than I am.
So, hello, I'm Lois. Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Should I just try to shout? Is that Thanks, sorry about that. So I'm sure you've all seen this before at some point. I mean, many of you have, you may not have done, but I thought because this is sort of where our service came from and the thinking that's behind it, I thought I should do a bit more explanation about what the different sections mean, and then afterwards coming on to what we do and where we actually fit into it. So this is the I Thrive model, and it was developed by the Anna Freud Centre in London. It's sort of replacing the old tier model, so, and there's various reasons that we've decided to use this model instead of the tier model, which I'll come on to, but essentially all children in Cambridgeshire are meant to fit into one of these five quadrants. So in the middle, you've got thriving. So this kind of represents the services that all children, universal services that all children may have access to and would support them sort of across the board. But then if there's a sort of a wellbeing need identified, they would fit into another of these four quadrants. So that starts with the getting advice quadrant, which means that if a child has access to a service in this quadrant, it means they have a need which can be sort of dealt with, improved, worked with minimal resource input. So this might mean parent training, it might mean guided self-help, it could be the use of websites, anything where a need can be sort of self-managed essentially with the help of parents, family members, social support. And then, so that's one category of need. Moving on from that, we've got the getting help and getting more help quadrants. So this is sort of the core work of mental health providers. And they provide like goal-based and outcome-focused manualized treatments. So there's the two sectors aren't conceptually different. They're both providing mental health input, but from a sort of a more, maybe a short session, short sort of six session intervention to more specialised sort of a CAMHS eating disorder pathway or a core CAMHS. That's sort of a difference. So it's not a conceptual difference, it's just based on the level of need. So if there's a more complex need, CAMHS involvement may be necessary. If the need is identified as mild to moderate, it may be that the input CHUMS or a counselling service such of similar may be more appropriate. And then the final section to talk about is the getting risk support. So the Thrive model tries to emphasise that there may be a group of young people who services don't feel comfortable discharging because there is a significant level of risk, so which has to be monitored in some fashion, but they are currently not able to access the services that may be in the getting help or getting more help sectors, whether this is due to difficulties of engagement or actually not having the kind of intervention available that might benefit that individual. This is where services that could help those individuals with SIT. So, essentially, establishing how children end up in one of these sectors is, it might seem complicated, but there is a rationale behind it. And the categories are basically supposed to be based on a conversation between what the young person and family want, what professionals can provide, and what professionals think is the best strategy for meeting their particular need. And I've been using the word need multiple times because that's supposed to be what the IFRO model is all about. So instead of having a tiered system where severity increases from tier 1 to tier 2 to tier 3 to tier 4, we have an emphasis on need, which implies that a child with a severe mental health problem could technically end up in any of these categories depending on what their specific need is at the time. So an example that I took from the Anna Freud website is a child who has a diagnosis of severe obsessive compulsive disorder may be offered medication and or a therapeutic input by a core CAM service. And they may choose to accept that intervention, or they may decide that at that point their need is not for that medication because it doesn't fit their current lifestyle and the side effects may be unacceptable to them. So therefore they may choose self-management, they may choose a short intervention, it's about their choice, their family's choice, and what professionals can offer. So this brings it back to their need rather than making a decision simply on the severity or the diagnosis in question. On the other hand, a child diagnosed with moderate obsessive compulsive disorder may choose medication if offered or choose a behavioural intervention if offered because at that time they see their need as treatment and it's the personal goal of theirs to have an improvement in their symptoms. So I've tried to outline the difference between severity and need there and how the Thrive model takes that into account. So after giving you that big spiel about the IFRO, I thought I'd talk about the aims of our service. So A1 is to be a system navigator, which means supporting professionals to access the right service at the right time for children in question that they may have concerns about. So this is it's designed to help you, as it says, navigate the system, to know when a CAMH referral might be appropriate, to know support with an early health assessment, all of these things that should streamline that process. And our second aim is direct intervention with schools in the form of training, consultation, a whole school approach, so anything along those lines. So a little bit more about system navigation. Basically, we want to have a good knowledge of the services available in the area, so when you make a call to us or an email with a referral, we can say actually this service would be the best to meet that particular child's need. And if that's CAMH, we'll say, okay, we can help you make that referral, we can help you to include the right information, which means the referral is more likely to be accepted. And along the lines of what Gina was saying earlier, we, as so many CAMS referrals don't meet threshold or don't contain the information necessary for a CAMS intervention to receive that service, we want to streamline that process and make sure the right children get the right services at the right time. So we won't be referring ourselves, but we will be supporting you to try and make that referral. So trying to call it back to the model with a little bit more information about what we do. We're not an intervention service, therefore we'll be sitting in this getting advice quadrant in terms of talking to education staff, saying, is this a concern? What level is the concern at? What strategies we might be able to suggest? and how we can help with referrals, or if there's a particular training needed in the school, if there's a particular problem that is occurring again and again, we can try and give you some training around that. I'll hand you back to Gina now.
Okay. So specific work within schools, what we can help you with, really. So things that we would expect to be offering you support with are things like anxiety, low mood, emotional and behavioural difficulties, attachment difficulties, bullying, stuff like that that you want to have that conversation about. It may be that you've just got that child and you kind of just know that something's not going well with them, you can't quite work it out, you want that professional to discuss it with. Two heads are better than one. We're those people that you can bounce that around with. Particularly the ones that don't quite meet the criteria for anything else. You know, you just maybe that it's a question of brainstorming your ideas and having someone else to help you sort of clear your picture, really, of what you're seeing. Our support can include what if conversations. A what if conversation is when it's anonymous. So you might be telling us the sex of the child, you'd be telling us the age of the child, and you'd be telling us the problems, but not actually their name. If you don't have their name, then we'd be giving you general advice. To give more support, really, and to be able to get in and have a look at their medical records, previous input, etc., we will need consent. And one of the things we'll be asking you to do, if you're contacting us, we'll be sending you out a referral form for you to either ask the parents to sign and give consent so that we can look at their medical records and we can share information with you that's relevant, that we can see, but you can't see as educators, or if they're old enough for their children to give their own consent. When we've had those conversations, sometimes we'll come out into school and we'll sit with you and we'll talk it through with you. It may be that there's a group of staff who are all having issues around this child. Again, we can do group work with them to do it. As Lois said, we're very keen on training you. Any training needs you feel you have. You might feel that you've got a pocket of children in your school that are all displaying roughly the same sort of symptoms or that you're worried about in the same way. And that might be an opportunity for us to come in and talk to you as a group and do some training around it. Also, we can be training the whole school for a whole school approach. Sort of how can we change things to generally make things better? On the whole, if we're changing something to improve one child's life, actually, if we roll it out as a wider thing, it's going to improve more people's lives. We're not going to write your referrals, as Lois said, but we are going to help you. We're going to help you look for the right services so that it becomes a more streamlined thing. So that the referrals are coming to the right services rather than several different services all getting the same referrals. We're going to help you with your formulations. We're going to help you get the right information onto those referrals. Sometimes as a clinician, and I've done it myself, you've just got all this information you want to put and actually it just gets really messy and the vital points get missed. We're hoping we're going to be empowering you as professionals, really. We recognise that as educators, you are the people who are going to be spending the most time with these children. You're the people who've got the relationships with them. You're the people who can tell whether there's something that's not going well with them. And we're going to use the fact that you've got these really good relationships to empower the staff to work with them, to make those changes and do these early interventions, which are hopefully going to help, stop them escalating into other services. And for in order for you to do that, we also recognise that you've got to feel confident about your knowledge with mental health, and you've got to have a support service behind you that you can go to and ask, and we are hoping to be that service for you. Also, we recognise that part of it is the whole well-being of the school, but part of that well-being is actually the well-being of the staff as well. If you're getting really stressed about situations and you haven't got anyone to discuss that with, then that's just going to escalate, isn't it? whereas actually if you've got someone you can discuss it with, then that's better. If a member of staff is talking to us, that same confidentiality would apply to them and the information and their worries about their child, or even their worries about their own training and what they're capable of. It stays with us. We're not, you know, it's not going to go on to your, whatever, you know, your assessments and end of year things, okay? And I think that's an important part, really. So if we could move on. That's it. So our inclusion criteria. So if you look, in Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, we've got slightly different inclusion criteria, and that's because of the other services that are there. Okay, so we're hoping to complement the other services. As you know, in Peterborough, you've got the project nurses. Have you come across those? Use them? Yeah. So they are working in primary schools. So our hope is that we're going to go into the senior schools and really do a lot of the same sort of things. We can offer the same things that the project nurses do. We can offer the classroom assessments. We can offer joint assessments. You can get pupils with you. It's open to everybody. The primary schools can still ring us for advice, but our targeted work really will be more in the senior schools in the Peterborough end. In Cambridgeshire, that's slightly different. They don't have the project nurses, so they are aimed more at primary school. The service is being aimed at this early intervention, so that to stop any problems and to build up the resilience of children, so that they don't carry on to have any bigger problems later on. Yeah. We've just included in here the project for school leaflet. Which is two slides. Do you want to go on to the next one as well? And they've got their own thing. Like us, they've gone for just a telephone number or an email as well. So again, they're very get-at-able, which is good. The other new service that's come recently is Chums. Some of you may have met them. They've been here today and everything else. You may be aware of them, or you may not. They're commissioned to do the direct work with the children and young people. They're going to offer support with mild to moderate mental health difficulties such as anxiety, low mood, as well as those with significant emotional and well-being difficulties arising from life events such as bereavement and bullying. Our service is not commissioned to do the direct work. I think it's unusual, and it's unusual for us as clinicians. But what we have been commissioned to do is to work with you, the professionals. At the moment, we are rolling this out in schools. We're going to be supporting you, the school staff. And it doesn't have to be the main head person. It might be a formal teacher. It can be any of the members of staff who need support. If it's a success, then we hope to roll it out into the other professionals. We might be, you know, we would like to be supporting in GP surgeries and things as well. Just so everybody has a heightened awareness and increase their knowledge around mental health. So how to get a hold of us? The important bits, really. So you can contact us on this telephone number. So our telephone line is going to be open between 9:30 in the morning and 4:30. During that time, there will be a practitioner on the end of that telephone. There is also an answering machine message if the line is busy. We've also got an email, which comes through to a central thing, and that email box is looked at daily. We're not an emergency service. If you're having a mental health crisis with a child or a young person, we're not the people to call. We are looking at doing long-term changes that change, you know, the bigger picture, that change the long-term outcomes. As I say, we're happy to do the what-if conversations, but we do need that consent if we're going to go into records and things. So if you are going to be having a conversation and you think you would like that more in-depth thing, you do need to be talking to the parents and letting them know that actually you are talking to us, which is good. We are new and developing a service. Every time we come out to see you, I'm afraid we're going to give you feedback forms because we have to evaluate how we're doing and how you like us. We're also going to be asking you for your views, really. You know, are we meeting your need? What would you like us to be doing?
doing. How are we going to get out and meet you all in the schools? As I say, we've actually only been open since the 15th of January, and we're still kind of feeling our way. If there's a meeting you think would be really good, you know, if we came along, like today, you know, a better way of meeting people, then please invite us and let us know. If you're emailing in and it's a Peterborough thing, or it's for a specific member of staff, if it's for myself or Faye, just put, you know, send it to the main thing, but just put for Gina or Faye. I don't think there's any other. No. I think we'll... Ryan's trying to wake me up, but sorry. Anyway, thanks very much for listening. I think there's some questions, an opportunity to answer any questions if anybody wants. Okay, thank you.